people. Our world is in a mess today. I mean, you can tell that just by looking at the amount of people that are here today. We're missing numerous, even of our own congregation today. And we're praying for them. We love them. We encourage them. But our world is in a giant mess, in fear and panic, not knowing what's to happen. In fact, I want to invite you back next week. I don't know if the Lord will allow me to preach this, but my spirit right now is wanting to preach on the end times and how does all, what, I want to preach a series called What in the World is Going On? All right, because all of these things are predicted in the Word of God. And I want to talk to you about that next Sunday, all right? So we're going to be in Philippians chapter 4 today. And so you can turn there in your Bibles. How many of you brought your Bible to church today? Raise it up. Amen. I know you got an e-book or a tree book. That's all right. Don't matter. All right. Just open it up today to Philippians chapter 4. And this is a letter that Paul wrote to a church that supported him, okay? And now Paul, of course, was not a missionary in what we would call the modern sense of the word. Paul was an apostle. In fact, we know that he was a tent maker. He supported himself if he needed to. He could just gather things he needed and make a tent and sell that. And so that was his profession. However, he is a person in the New Testament who did receive financial support from local churches, much like a modern day missionary. And let me just say that our missionaries today that we support are not tent makers. They don't have a secular job. At least most of them don't. They give themselves full time into the ministry, into the mission that God has called them to be in. And of course, they need a salary. They need a job. They need a salary. They need insurance, cars, kids' clothes, food, all those things that are necessary for life in a modern world. But let's read some of Paul's reflections as he's sharing with this church that has been supporting him, all right? How many of you know the Word is powerful? Come on, do you love the Word today? I love it, amen. Philippians chapter 4 and verse number 10, I'm going to read this verse out of the New International Version. It says this, "I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. Nevertheless, you have done well that you shared in my distress. Now, you Philippians know that also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities." Okay, now I want you to notice that he's very grateful, right? Paul is a grateful guy. He's received financial support for the things that he's needed, and he was happy about that. But I want you to notice in the next verse what he says, that it's not just that it's going to be a benefit for himself, but it's also going to benefit actually those who were the givers, all right? Notice this next verse. It says, "Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account." You say, "Pastor Bob, why are you preaching on missions today? Why are you doing this?" I want to tell you why. Because I'm seeking the fruit that can abound to your account, all right? How many of you say, "Pastor, I want a fruit in my account," all right? We'll talk about what account that is a little bit later on. Paul says, "Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God." And then, interestingly enough, Paul gives a powerful, powerful promise. How many of you believe the promises of the Word today? How many of you believe that these just aren't written for somebody else? They're written for you and for me. Come on, somebody. It says this, "And my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen." So stop and consider this morning, that this powerful promise that many times we quote it all by itself. Many people know this verse by heart, by memory. But how interesting that this promise was given in context of a church that had been supporting Paul in the mission that he had been doing around the world in that day. I don't know about you, but I want to activate that promise in my life. Come on. And so I want to ask you this question. Is giving support for missionaries and traveling ministries, is that a biblical thing to do? How many of you think we ought to understand that, right? Is this something we ought to be concerned about as Christians? Is this biblical? Should we do it? How many of you realize that even Jesus Christ received financial support? It's true. Even Jesus did. Luke 8 and verse 3 says this, "And Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna," and note what it says, "and many others who provided for him," for Jesus, "from their sustenance." Wow. Now think about that for a moment. You know, Jesus could, if he could take a few loaves and fishes and feed 5,000 people with it, come on, he really didn't have much need of, you know, of money in the sense, because he could just, you know, look at a rock and turn it into gold. Come on. He was the Son of the living God. But he, instead of doing that, he allowed people to support him. Why? It's because Jesus knew by example that this was an important thing and that the ministry needs to be supported. Also, we can go back in 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse number 9. There was a great prophet back then by the name of Elijah. He had called for a famine in the land. A raven had fed him for a while by a brook. But the scripture tells us this, that the Lord spoke to him and said, "Arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you." You say, well, did this widow have a lot of money? Was she wealthy? Was she rich? Oh, absolutely not. She was about ready to take her last little bit of cornmeal that she had and her last little bit of oil and put it together and make, a little cake, feed some of it to her son, eat some of it herself, and then to perish and to starve. And interestingly enough, along comes the prophet and he says, "Make me a cake first." Now, as you look at that, we think to ourselves, man, Elijah, seriously? This little boy is hungry. You're going to eat the first cake? But you see, it had to do with priority, right? It had to do with putting God first. And interestingly enough, because this little lady, this widow lady and her son put the ministry first, the scripture says this, that the bin of flour never got used up, that the jar of oil didn't run dry. Come on, somebody give the Lord a hand of praise today. Amen. I'm just here today to tell you that God knows how to bless those who know how to give. Come on, God is bigger than our finances. If you believe that, let's give him a big hand of praise today. Amen. God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He owns the gold in those hills. Amen. And if we are going to be faithful to this word, if we're going to believe God, if we're going to follow this word, there are some principles in this passage that we've got to get a hold of in our heart today. And the first one is this. Number one, we must often renew our giving to missions. We've got to renew our giving to missions. Now, many years ago, I was a missionary. That was about 23 years ago. And I was a missionary for 7 years, and I know how it feels to get that statement every month and look and see the churches, the individuals that supported me as I was in Cartagena, Colombia, planting churches and doing that. And what I know about missionaries is quite a bit, actually, having been one. And missionaries, at least in the Assemblies of God, they have to come home about every 3 to 4 years to spend some time raising further support. And Paul said this in Philippians 4:10. He said, "I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed," everybody say renewed, "renewed your concern for me." You see, while Paul was in Rome under house arrest, apparently in those days, in prisons, you know, if someone didn't bring you food, you didn't have any. If someone didn't bring you any clothes, you had what you wore into the prison. And Paul was wrapped up in prison, and so this church had sent food and clothing and money. And interestingly enough, that word renewed is a horticultural term that's used of a flower or a tree budding or blossoming. And it seems that for some reason or another, the Philippians had not been supporting Paul as they had at the beginning. And so that had dropped off for some reason. They were concerned for him, but they didn't have any opportunity to show it. We don't really know why. We do know that Macedonia was a very poor place for some, and that maybe it was that they was far away physically or some other reason they didn't give. But anyway, they decided to renew their efforts. And for this, Paul was really rejoicing, all right? And so similar to the Philippians, our giving should be continually renewed like a flower in blossom as well. Amen. How many say, I want to be a giver? Come on, who says, I want to be a giver like the Lord is? Amen. In fact, you know, the scripture tells us that we're not supposed to just be givers, that we're actually supposed to excel in the realm of giving. Excel in giving. In other words, if we were to line people up in our culture and they were to examine the giving habits of each person, those who are believers in Jesus Christ, come on, they ought to be the ones that give the most. Amen. They ought to be the ones that are giving. Amen. So remember that when you give a tip at the restaurant. Come on, somebody. Amen. This is what it says, 2 Corinthians 8:7. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. How many of you know that as a Christian, we need to excel in the way that we speak, in the way that we talk? We need to excel in understanding, in the understanding of God's Word and the Scripture. We need to excel especially in the love that we have for people, right? Loving people around us, at work, wherever we're at. Amen. We're supposed to be concerned about others that are around us. And Paul says, you're doing well in all these things, but don't forget to excel in the realm of giving. So the question today is, are you blossoming in this realm of giving? Are you really excelling? And this morning at the end of this message, we're going to give you an opportunity to participate in that. And then secondly, we've got to be intentional about our giving. We've got to be intentional. How many of you know that if you're not intentional about things, you know, nothing will happen? Let me give you a few things you need to be intentional about. When you talk to your loved one on the phone, when you're saying goodbye, just tell them you love them. Come on, somebody. Be intentional about it. Just say, I love you. I talked to my dad last night, and as we hung up the phone, I said, I love you, Dad. And he said, I love you, son. Amen. I think that's important. If it's somebody's birthday in your family, be intentional about it. Come on. Buy them a birthday present. Get them a card. Have a party. Get them a cake. Do whatever's necessary. Hello. Husbands, hear me today. Be intentional about your anniversary. Don't forget that. Hello. I'm trying to stay physically active and physically fit and work out at least 3 times a week, and I've got to put that in my schedule. I've got to be intentional about it. It's easy for me to just forget about that. And let me tell you something. If we believe, how many of you believe the gospel's important? The world is lost. The world needs hope. The gospel is incredibly important. And if we believe that feeding the poor and helping the orphan and building churches and raising up Bible colleges and evangelizing the world, if you think that's important, then you can't just push it to the back of your mind. You've got to be intentional about it and say, listen, I'm not going to just think about these things. I'm going to do some of these things. Amen. Philippians 4 tells us this. Paul's writing to this church. We read it a moment ago. He says, you've done well that you shared in my distress. A little bit later, he says, you giving and receiving, but you only, for even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. He was saying, wow, I can tell you're intentional about giving. You know I have a need here now that I'm in prison, and now you're giving, and it's faithful and it's regular. Come on. So let me just give you a few thoughts today, all right? The first question is this, why should I give my money through the church?